Like many other people, I have been very fascinated by Tony Stark and all of his various Iron Man suits, and I've been working on a huge video detailing every single armor that he's ever built. But as I do my research, I've actually found myself increasingly more interested in all the armors that Tony has built for other people. So that's why I started writing this video. I thought it was going to be quick and easy and fun, you know, talk about War Machine and the Iron Spider. But as I researched more and more, combing through decades of Iron Man comics, I kept finding more and more armors to talk about, and the video got longer and longer. Why does Luke Cage need an Iron Man suit? But after lots of sleepless nights and a lot more coffee, I think I finally have a comprehensive list. But before we get too far into things, I want to give a big thank you to our sponsor for today's video, Surfshark VPN. The internet can be a very scary and dangerous place, so you should protect yourself with a virtual private network, much like Iron Man would with a suit of armor. Honestly, having a VPN is just a smart move overall, as it lets you protect your identity online, which means you're a lot less likely to deal with annoying things like targeted ads, and websites aren't able to collect your region-based data to adjust the prices of products that you're looking at. Oh, and don't forget about region-locked content, too. By changing your device's region, you can access all sorts of content that's not available in your country. But that's not all. With Surfshark's hacklock system, you'll be alerted in case your email or passwords get leaked online, so that you can protect yourself from being further compromised. Not to mention that Surfshark has 24-hour support, a 30-day money-back guarantee, and no data logging whatsoever. I personally use Surfshark every single day, so I definitely vouch for the product. So if you want to protect yourself like me, then make sure you go to surfshark.com/comicdrake and use the code comicdrake at checkout for 85% off and 3 additional months for free. But anyway, back to the video. Early in his career, Tony wanted to retire from his role as Iron Man. Shortly after coming to this decision, he met a man named Eddie March, a boxer who idolized the Armored Avenger and even called himself Iron Man while in the ring. After having to hang up his gloves due to a blood clot in his brain, Eddie jumped at the offer to take over as Iron Man when Stark mentioned the opportunity to him. Instead of just giving Eddie the suit though, Tony instead custom built a brand new set of armor that's virtually identical to the original, but with a two-way radio link and tracking devices so that Stark could monitor Eddie's location and status. On literally his first mission out, Eddie was massively hurt by a dude named the Crimson Dynamo, which prompted Tony to take the mantle back for himself, swearing that he would always be Iron Man forever. Until literally a year later, when Tony decided to give up on his life as Iron Man, again, now wanting his friend Kevin O'Brien to take his place. However, instead of just giving him an existing Iron Man suit or building a new one, Stark instead built the Guardsman armor. This suit was a slightly less powerful version of the Iron Man armor, but has all of the usual trademarks like flight and repulsor rays. However, the suit was still untested, which means that when Kevin put it on to help Stark out when he was in trouble, it was bad news. You see, the suit stimulated the parts of Kevin's brain that control rage and jealousy, which caused him to develop a serious crush on Tony's girlfriend, Marion Rogers. Now fueled by this jealousy, O'Brien started working with Simon Gilbert, the chairman of the Stark Industries board of directors, who was wanting to kick Tony out as the president of the company. This ultimately led to a fight, which was pretty one-sided since the Guardsman armor was already weaker than Iron Man, not to mention that Tony had intentionally built a weak point into the suit in case it was ever used against him. In order to tip the odds back in his favor, O'Brien switched to using an experimental tank, which Tony accidentally hit the fuel supply of, which caused the tank to explode and kill Kevin. Years later, Kevin's brother Michael stole the Guardsman suit and tried to use it to avenge his brother, but suffered from the same mental affliction of the untested suit. After they fought, Stark brought Michael to his lab in order to fix the brain damage while also working on a new set of Iron Man armor for himself. But when the mutant Sunfire was causing problems, Stark had to use the Guardsman armor since his new Iron Man suit wasn't ready yet. After seeing how selfless Tony was, Michael started to realize that Tony was telling the truth when he said that the armor made both him and his brother go insane. And it's this change of heart that led to Tony Stark fixing up the Guardsman armor and letting Michael keep it. Future iterations of the Guardsman armor do exist, but they weren't made by Tony, so let's move on to the next entry, the Mandroids. These are multiple suits of armor that were created by Stark for S.H.I.E.L.D. that were specifically designed to take on superpowered enemies. The only problem is that a Skrull was posing as the head of the Alien Activities Commission and sicked the Mandroids on the Avengers, moving them via remote control with unconscious pilots inside.
In addition to augmenting the wearer's strength, the Mandroid armor is also full of goodies such as lasers and anti-magnetism tech. However, this wouldn't be enough to stop the Avengers, since thanks to Tony Stark's intimate knowledge of the design since he literally made them, they were able to stop the Mandroids. Stark improved upon the design for the Mandroid Mark II with upgrades like jet boots and force field generators. But even though these new models became the standard issue for S.H.I.E.L.D., the Mark I's were getting kept in circulation as well. Though, due to the sheer number of Marks 1 and 2 that were made, the Mandroid armors became a favorite of the criminal underground to steal and modify for their own uses. Yet, criminals aren't the only ones to get their hands on decommissioned armor. Most notably, J. Jonah Jameson was able to get his hands on some Mark II's when he became the mayor of New York City, giving them to the NYPD with modified Spider-Slayer technology for his vendetta against Spider-Man. Tax dollars at work. Much like the Guardsman suit, additional models of the Mandroid armor were created, but they weren't made by Tony Stark, so again, let's move on. For a good period of time, Tony's longtime friend, James Rhodes, took over the mantle of Iron Man using the existing armor, but Stark began to craft a brand new set for him called the Silver Centurion. Unfortunately, Rhodey was hurt in an explosion, which led to Stark deciding to don it himself and becoming Iron Man once again. Later on, Tony developed yet another new suit called the War Machine, and he used it to fight a group of bad guys called the Masters of Silence. This was probably the most 90s Iron Man armor imaginable, with an edgy gray color palette, guns galore, a laser, and a flamethrower. It's just completely rad. A few issues later though, Stark seemingly died, and his holographic will stated that the suit was modified and left specifically for Rhodey. Ever since then, Rhodey has really made the War Machine mantle his own, and over the years he's gone through several different iterations of the armor. The weapons and capabilities of the War Machine suits that have come and gone are so numerous that it wouldn't really make sense to list them all here. That would probably require a video in and of itself, so if that sounds interesting, let me know down there in the comments. But don't worry, Rhodey is going to be making a few more appearances in this video. But before we move on to the next entry, I want to give a quick shout out to the Punisher back when he wore the War Machine armor. I'm not the biggest Punisher fan, but that was pretty cool. Way back in the 90s, Captain America's Super Soldier Serum was starting to fail him, and during a fight with Mr. Hyde, Cap suffered from a massive heart attack that left him completely paralyzed. Enter Tony Stark. He made a set of power armor that Steve is able to control with his mind thanks to a biochip implant. Outside of simply getting Cap from point A to point B though, this armor is chock full of other features like flight, telescopic lenses, compressed air cannons, energy scanners, anti-missile missiles, a disorientation beam that knocks off an enemy's core coordination, Mylex shrouds to wrap people up, and magnetic gauntlets that call back Captain America's shield when it's thrown. Oh, and apparently when the armor is pierced, it unleashes Pym particles that shrink the weapon. Eventually, Captain America was able to get back on his feet thanks to blood and marrow transfusions from the Red Skull, so he no longer needed the suit, but it got pulled out of storage years later when a bad guy took all of the Super Soldier Serum out of Cap's blood. But he got better, so the suit is gone once again. I love this next entry so much that I actually have a dedicated video breaking it down. But when Peter Parker was working for Tony Stark, he was given my all-time favorite Spider-Man suit, the Iron Spider Armor. This incredibly badass suit has an insane amount of features like being bulletproof, glider wing pits, a truckload of scanners and sensors, a built-in air supply, and ports in his wrists that open up to allow for Spider-Man to fire his organic webbing and use his stingers back when he had those. I also have a dedicated video explaining that as well because, wow, that's also complicated. In the very next issue, Stark further upgraded the suit. It's now made out of a liquid metal that can vanish on a whim, allow for Peter to become invisible, and also change its appearance. Parts of the suit can also be fired off and operated through Peter's mind, similar to a symbiote. Plus, we can't forget about the Waldos. They're these extendable limbs with built-in cameras that can also grip things. During the Superhuman Civil War, Peter ended up defecting from Iron Man's side to the Resistance, and as a result, the Iron Spider suit was massively torn up in a fight with its creator. Since then, the Iron Spider has made several minor appearances, but since they were all without Tony's involvement, let's move on. This one's a quick entry since I'm not sure that it really counts, but after the House of M event, the Office of National Emergency created a unit of soldiers to pilot Sentinels that were modified by Tony Stark. Led by Rhodey, the Sentinel Squad had various types of Sentinel units to pick from for standard combat, and even bigger and stronger ones for when they needed to take on larger threats. That's all that I really wanted to say, since they were more of just Stark upgrades rather than entirely original suits. Though Rhodes does get this other Iron Man armor that seems to be different from everything else, but I couldn't find any information of it other than like this one appearance, so who knows? After the Civil War, Tony Stark became the director of S.H.I.E.L.D. and created a four-man special ops group called Alpha Team. These guys were given less sophisticated versions of Iron Man's armor, but they're more tactical and militaristic in design and function. For example, instead of having repulsors built into the suits, they instead have these non-lethal repulsor rifles, although they can go lethal if need be. Other than that, the Alpha Team armor seems to be the usual enhanced strength, flight, and scanning tech that you would expect from an Iron Man suit. But there was one really cool addition in the form of the Ferasense. This knockoff version of the Spider-Sense was a short-lived feature of Stark's armor after he made it from the data that he had on Spider-Man back when Peter worked for him. We've never really seen the Ferasense since, but due to all of the memory and reality wiping shenanigans that the Marvel Universe was experiencing around that time, it's to be expected. Alpha Team was another short-lived concept that we didn't really get to see a whole lot of, and after Tony Stark was no longer the director of S.H.I.E.L.D., we didn't see them anymore, so who knows where these suits are these days. But the Alpha Team suits aren't all that Tony built while leading S.H.I.E.L.D. When he learned about a possible Skrull invasion, Tony went to work on building a massive satellite in space completely off the books. Of course, this is Iron Man that we're talking about, so naturally, this also transforms into a giant mech. Now, if this thing looks like a giant war machine to you, that's actually intentional. You see, Stark only trusted Rhodey, who at this time was a cyborg because comics, to pilot it, and for a short period of time, Rhodes actually used this as a mobile base of operations, seldom transforming it. As far as weapons go, it seems to be the usual war machine fare of missiles and energy beams, but bigger. After the Skrulls had their secret invasion, S.H.I.E.L.D. was shut down and replaced by a new organization called Hammer that was led by Norman Osborn. In order to stop the literal supervillain in charge of an international spy organization from getting a hold of such secrets like the secret identities of superheroes, Tony uploaded all of that data into his brain and went on the run. In the meantime, he left Pepper Potts an armored suit of her own to help with dangerous threats. Now, when you hear the name Iron Man Mark 1616, you'd think that that would mean that Tony has created over 1,500 suits, but in reality, it's just a code for Pepper's initials, PP. Later named Rescue, this suit was designed for heavy rescue and recovery missions. This thing is all defense without a single weapon on board. I mean, heck, even its flight capabilities don't emit heat. The rescue armor has all sorts of fun features, like magnetic field manipulation, force fields that are strong enough to catch a crashing plane, and even 96,000 of Pepper's favorite songs. Eventually, Tony deleted his brain in order to erase the information that he took from S.H.I.E.L.D. that was on it, and the rescue armor was stripped for parts in order to build a device that was capable of rebooting Tony's brain. Once he was back to normal, Tony built Pepper a brand new rescue suit, and we've seen a couple more iterations since, with the most recent model sporting the blue color scheme that was seen in the Marvel Cinematic Universe's adaptation of the rescue suit. So this next entry is actually three separate suits. You see, when it was discovered that the villainous Mr. Sinister had genetic samples of everyone on the planet, Tony Stark and friends raided his hideout. In order to sneak in under the radar, Tony gave his pals some stealth armor that he had laying around, which was all conveniently designed with each of them in mind for some reason. Instead of a new Iron Spider suit, Spider-Man was equipped with armor that's much more akin to Iron Man's, but it also had built-in web shooters. And how Tony knew how to make these, I have no idea, because when the Iron Spider suit was made, that's when Peter had his organic webbing. So I guess Tony was also able to figure out how web shooters work, but that's also not been common knowledge. Okay, I am starting to nerdy nitpick way too much. X-23's armor had slots for her claws to pop through, Jessica Jones' armor had rockets, and Luke Cage has this big wrecking ball hand. These suits were very short-lived, and they only appeared for these two issues, and honestly, I would not be surprised if these never showed up ever again. Despite War Machine being Rhodey's mantle, it does seem like Tony is still making the occasional War Machine suit, specifically the War Widow armor. Wow, that's a tongue twister. As the name implies, this was made for Black Widow, and it has all the firepower that you would expect, including guns on her gauntlets that seem to operate like her Widow Bites. We only got to see this armor the one time when Natasha used it out in space, so that's kind of all we know about it. It's Black Widow
in space!
So because I know that that is a very disappointing note to end on, let me throw out a couple of honorable mentions that don't really count, but that I know people are going to want me to mention anyway. There's the Iron Patriot armor that was actually an existing Iron Man suit that was modified by Norman Osborn. Later versions include drones made by the Department of Defense using Norman's old model that eventually became a suit worn by Rhodey, and a separate Iron Patriot armor was worn by Tony Ho as a part of the US Avengers. And there's also this suit that Squirrel Girl wore, which was actually a mishmash of multiple armor pieces that she and her squirrels stole from Stark's lab.
God, I hope that was everything. But honestly, after combing through so much lore, I'm sure that I missed like one or two things that slipped between my fingers. So if I did, then please be sure to let me know respectfully down there in the comments below. But if you like this video, then why not consider subscribing or even watching another one? And if you liked this, well, chances are you probably like Iron Man. So I actually have a dedicated playlist for every single one of my Iron Man videos. This was pretty good. I mean, I'm a little biased, but maybe you'll like those too. I don't know. But anyway, I hope you learned at least a little something new, and hopefully, I'll see you next time.